It's out of the way. I'm delighted to welcome our keynote speaker this morning, our patron Tony Juniper. Tony is an independent sustainability and environment advisor, including a special advisor with the Prince of Wales's International Sustainability Unit, fellow of the University of Cambridge Institute for Sustainability Leadership, and co-founder of the sustainability consulting group Roberts Bridge. And Tony's going to talk to us this morning about conserving the people, why we need biodiversity in our towns and cities. Thank you, Tony.
Thank you very much indeed. Great pleasure to be here this morning. When I was asked to come and contribute to something around mainstreaming biodiversity in cities, I was immediately taken back to the early part of my career as a conservationist and just thinking about how things were in the late 1970s and early 1980s. And back then, as now, conservation was a discipline largely driven by ecological science, trying to determine priorities based upon rarity and naturalness and these kinds of values, and to be seeing this very much as a program to conserve nature for its own sake. And of course, that still remains a very big part of the picture. But during the early 1980s, there was a change beginning to appear, and it was seen in the rise of the urban wildlife movement in this country. And the establishment of London Wildlife Trust in 1981 was one particular landmark. And I remember back then thinking to myself, well, why are people wasting their time trying to conserve a few bits of scrubby habitat for starlings in the centre of London when we've got crashing and collapsing populations of wild birds and butterflies in the countryside? And of course, the reason was because conservation in that context had a whole set of additional and different values being added to it. And at that point, I guess we can see that conservation in the early 1980s, as represented by the urban wildlife movement, was also adding the idea that conserving biodiversity was also about conserving the people, and bringing these two things together with a very strong social dimension was a very new and very exciting part of the jigsaw. And those benefits, as we've gone along, of course, have become ever more evident as we've gathered more and more data, compiling the information to show that access to nature is actually very good for people in a variety of different ways. One of the hats I wear at the moment is to have the privilege of being the president of the Wildlife Trust, and I see some of the work going on across the country, not only in urban areas now, where this social piece and the well-being of humankind has been very strongly built into the programme. And there's a very compelling report compiled by the Trusts a few months ago, I'm sure you can find it on their website, looking at the body of evidence out there now, showing us the very positive linkages between human well-being and health and the conservation of natural environments. And as you can imagine, the more people there are closer to the natural environments, then the bigger the aggregate benefits for society. And of course, most people living in cities is where you get the biggest bang for your buck. And so those pieces are increasingly clear from data, not only instinct. And if you visit some of the cities where you have a lot of green space, you can immediately see the benefits for that. One of my favorite cities is Copenhagen. Literally hundreds of kilometers of cycleways and walkways there, connecting the suburbs to the town center via areas with woodlands, with grasslands, and with water features, including man-made lakes that are now very rich in bird life, fish and insects and all the rest of it. I'm lucky enough to live in Cambridge, another city that has lots of green space connecting the city center to the countryside as well as to the suburbs, and people use that all the time. They cycle and they walk, and of course, as you can imagine, this leads to health benefits. Some of the health benefits we know that come with access to nature, including for urban groups, may be slightly less obvious, and one is the incidence of allergies, and there's research out there now telling us how the children growing up in proximity to natural areas and to farming have lower incidence of allergies than children growing up remote from those kinds of places. Access to the microbes, the exposure of our immune system to these elements of nature, it's not something that most people would see as obvious, but it's there in the data, and we can increasingly appreciate the benefit of all of that. On top of these kinds of benefits for physical health in terms of being able to interact with natural areas and cities. Of course, the really big ticket that we're beginning to understand from research is the benefits for psychological health. You just look at some of the medical data being published in this country and other Western democracies, and you find that there's been a very sharp increase in the incidence of stress, depression, and anxiety and other psychological disorders, causing immense misery for people and, of course, causing costs for society. And we can, of course, treat those conditions with drugs. And if you look at the rate of prescriptions for Prozac and other drugs treating some of these kinds of problems, you can see they're rocketing upwards. And you can look at sewage works and speak to water companies about those drugs accumulating in wastewater. And you know we've got really quite a major change taking place in our society right now as we're suffering from these kinds of sometimes low-level psychological problems, sometimes which turn into really quite serious problems for people who are suffering from those. But we know from research that we can help to avoid and indeed treat some of these problems through enabling people to have more access and exposure to natural features, to be able to hear birdsong, to walk in woodlands, and of course to be able to breathe fresh air, all of which we know helps people to feel better. And you can see those benefits across all age groups, including in children, where we know that the more time people spend outside, young people spend outside, the better we can expect to see outcomes in terms of hyperactivity disorders and how people's young people's relationships work with one another. They improve when you've got more time being spent outside. Some of these benefits we're beginning to quantify. So the Natural Capital Committee, which has been gathering data, presenting analysis to the UK Treasury, trying to understand some of the ways in which natural systems are contributing to our economy. You may remember, actually it's still there, isn't it, in some political discussions, we're given the idea that looking after nature is a cost, a burden, it's going to harm job creation and damage economic growth. Well, the Natural Capital Committee is showing us how that's not true, and in fact we're getting immense value for our health, wealth and security coming from the conservation of natural areas. But what the Natural Capital Committee has told us is that those economic values are biggest near to where most people live. But when you start looking at some of that health data, you can see why they might start to reach those conclusions. Then you start to look at some of the health trends that are in play already and which we're expecting to intensify during the coming decades. So it's already costing us an estimated £100 billion per year to cope with the effects of mental illness. That's not only health costs, that's people losing time at work. And we're expecting over the next couple of decades to see the national bill for obesity to rise to about £60 billion. These are immense numbers, and in the case of type 2 diabetes and some other chronic conditions, these are really, really costly for the National Health Service because people don't die. They go on, sometimes in really quite poor health, with heart conditions, suffering from high blood pressure and so on. But these things are going to get worse the less active our society is. So would it be sensible to invest in these kinds of green infrastructure solutions near to where people live in cities to take the edge off of some of this? And when you start looking at these kinds of numbers, 100 billion, 60 billion, even if you could reduce the incidence of that by 1%, surely that is going to be a very cost-effective contribution to the future of our country. So why don't we take £1 billion from the National Health Service budget and spend it on green infrastructure in cities to increase bird populations, to increase wild areas, to beautify our rivers? Surely that would be a very sensible economic judgment, never mind one for the conservation of wildlife. Another big picture benefit that you can see from going down this route of increasing and enhancing green areas in cities is the extent to which it might help to take the edge off of another big social problem we've got, namely inequality. We know from the data that the people who benefit most from access to green areas are those who are most excluded on lower incomes and who are at the bottom of our society. They're suffering from high stress, they smoke, they drink a lot, they're not having a very good life. But if those people get access to green areas, we know that deprivation indices go down. We've got data for this as well. So children in deprived areas 9 times less likely to have access to green spaces, and we know from other data that that's going to lead to less good behaviour. And we know that in Denmark, people living more than a kilometre from green areas, again, are going to be showing higher levels of deprivation compared to those people with high deprivation living close to green areas. So these are basic facts that have really big social implications, and it's not only for health, but also some other social problems that we can see evidence to show the benefits of green spaces. One study that I know of from Chicago showed that when people lived in green areas, similar populations of people suffering high levels of deprivation, the people living in the greener areas had less domestic violence than those living in the less green areas. So these are multiple benefits laid on top of each other. And so on top of the benefits for health and some of these social indicators, and indeed for psychological well-being, we know that green areas can also help to protect us from some kinds of urban air pollution. So in this country, we're suffering from an epidemic of illnesses being caused by particulates and other pollution in the atmosphere, mostly coming from transport, some of it coming from other energy use. It's causing something like 40,000 premature deaths in this country. Would you believe that during the entire Second World War, the number of civilian deaths in this country was about 60,000? So if you look at the Department of Health data, every 18 months, the equivalent number of people who died in the Second World War in this country who were non-combatants are dying from air pollution. That just seems to me like a very big number and something that should be leading to big changes in behaviour, including the extension and enhancement of green spaces in cities, because we know that pollution, some kinds of pollution, can be removed from the atmosphere by trees and grasses, reducing the incidence of respiratory problems, heart diseases, and indeed some kinds of cancers. So, obviously, this is not an alternative to going down the route of electrification and public transport and cycling, but certainly it would be something that could help in those places where most of us live. And it's not only pollution from particulates and nitrogen oxides that are causing problems for humankind. Of course, the carbon dioxide pollution that's building up in the atmosphere is now changing the climate. We know that very well. And we've also had a glimpse, a little taster, of some of the likely consequences of this over recent decades. One example that we might wish to reflect upon would be the 2003 heat wave that killed about 40,000 people, premature deaths across the European region, mostly in France, also several hundred here. And that, of course, was down to heat stroke, and most of those people were living in urban areas. And we know that the urban heat island effect will be exacerbated by some of these very extreme temperatures. And that 2003 summer, the climatologists are telling us that by 2040, we can expect that to be a normal one. Of course, we know that in urban areas, you can reduce the heat island effect by having more vegetation. So should we be investing in green space, not only for health and avoiding some of the impacts of pollution, but also for climate change resilience? Well, the answer is, of course, we should. And of course, on top of extreme heat, one of the other climate change impacts that we can expect coming down the track will be in relation to extreme rainfall events and the extent to which we might avoid some of that through better planning of green spaces to get water into the ground rather than running off hard surfaces and causing surface water flooding or rivers to go over their banks. Now, we've already passed the point when more than half of the population of the world lives now in cities. This is an historic moment, especially when you think back to the history of humankind and the beginning of our species and the fact that we're actually very recently an urban animal. And for 99% of our past, you can see that we didn't live in cities. We were either hunter-gatherers or we were farming. In 2007, half of 6.8 billion of us were then urban dwellers. That number is expected to increase to 70% by 2050, at which point the population will have grown to over 9 billion. So if you do a little back of the envelope calculation on what that means, you can roughly predict that between now and mid-century, the additional urban capacity that's going to be created on planet Earth will be roughly the same as 175 times the size of London today. Think about that in terms of the ways in which this is going to be shaping different outcomes for people. Seems to me that that new urban space, and indeed and some of it will be here, and indeed the urban space that we already have, will need to be managed in a much more 21st century manner than it presently is being, anticipating, based upon current trends and what we know, some of those issues of the future. How are we going to stop people getting overweight? How are we going to stop so many people suffering from psychological problems? How are we going to deal with more and more people driving in bigger and bigger cities? How are we going to deal with the impacts of climate change? And indeed, how are we going to do all of this whilst cutting carbon and conserving the biodiversity in the cities that we know is not only good for people, but also is becoming an increasingly important conservation concern? And as we've gone on this journey from seeing urban wildlife as a social issue, at the same time, we've had declining wildlife populations in the countryside to the point now, in many cities, the wildlife is better than the countryside around it. And certainly in Cambridge, where I live, you see more songbirds, bats and amphibians there than you do if you go into the Fens. So we've kind of come full circle, and the question now is really how are we going to take all of this forward. And it's not only how we take this forward from the point of view of those practical benefits and what we might do to improve some wildlife populations, there's an even wider context for all of this, and it's a cultural one. You know, when you recognise that the human experience until very recently was one of being very close to nature, experiencing all of these things at an emotional and personal level, to the point where many people understood that nature actually was sustaining humankind. If you speak to many people today, especially urban dwellers, they don't know that. They don't even know it at an intellectual level, but they know it even less at a personal, emotional level. And that is a problem. Because when you let people know that we've got issues with climate change, ecosystem collapse, pollution, and resource depletion, if they don't really know what you're talking about, then they're probably not going to do very much about it. And I think if you look at the extent to which that cultural connection becomes increasingly severed, I think you can see really big implications for the future. As more and more of us become urban, and more of us are less and less connected to the reality of how this planet works, that then becomes an issue in terms of what consumers choose to buy, who they're prepared to vote for, and what they're prepared to believe in terms of some of the things being said about all of these subjects. And you can already see that happening with people willing to believe non-scientific views about what's happening on our planet. And the reason for that is because they don't know any better at a very personal level. So we have multiple reasons to want to mainstream biodiversity into our cities and to make our urban areas much more connected, and that I don't think really any longer is a matter for debate amongst those who are close to the technical data, but of course is one that needs to be spread far further amongst some other groups. We can see that the opportunity is indeed huge, but it's only going to be grasped through better planning, more integrated approaches, and the more thoughtful use of existing natural areas and green spaces and creating new ones. If we're going to do that, a lot of other people need to be on the journey with us, government ministers, health departments, those designing future housing estates, and all the rest. And this is in part about painting a picture whereby we get beyond that view that's still held by many at a kind of deep-rooted level, whereby green is seen as backward-looking, it's holding the economy down. We need to be opening up green spaces for development, for commercial opportunities. In fact, people need to be seeing the information telling us a different picture, whereby the protection and enhancement of green areas in cities is highly cost-effective, economically rational, and very good for the way economies will work into the future, as well as bringing conservation benefits. So the evidence is largely in place. It seems to me that we now need to spread awareness and make the case, and I very much hope that today's conference will be part of that process. Thank you very much indeed.
Mary. Tony, thank you very, very much indeed for that very stimulating introduction to this marvellous conference, and congratulations to CIEM for setting it up. Have we got to a point now, both in town and country, that we need to now restructure the biological base, really starting from our soils?
Yes.
And do you think, you might have some inside knowledge of what's going on in government, do you think the 25-year environment plan will reach as deep as you and I suspect everybody else in this room really wants it to go?
Well, thank you very much. So, yes, we do. And so a lot of the work I've been doing over the last couple of years has led me to conclude that quite a lot of the forward environmental plan now needs to go back to basics. And I would say that soil and water are the two things where we need a much bigger focus. And if you get those two things right, you kind of work backwards in terms of fertilizers, pesticides, farming methods, natural features, mixed farming. And if you can improve the health of those two things, quite a lot else of what we need will follow with it, including, you know, more carbon in the ground as a result of increased soil organic matter. So that, I think, is an important thing for us to remember. When it comes to that 25-year environment plan, that was put into the manifesto before we embarked on this mad idea of leaving the European Union, of course. And so for me, this now becomes a very important part of what we now have to look at in terms of the post-Brexit Britain that's approaching us. Well, one thing to say, of course, is that it must not be separate to the 25-year farming plan. Ministers think these two things somehow are separate. If you take the view that soil and water are important, then obviously they're not. But then again, we can kind of have that discussion with them at the same time. I've reached the conclusion that that 25-year environment plan, it needs to be strong, obviously, but given that we're about to leave the European Union, I think it should be the foundation for an Act of Parliament that sets some targets for all of these subjects, given that we're about to have major uncertainty in terms of habitat, birds directive, water framework directive, and everything else. And if we're going to have that, we need a strong base. And if we're going to take back control, I think most voters would like it to be for a better place to live, wouldn't you think? Rather than one where the standards drop and we're suffering even worse air pollution and worse water quality. So the 25-year plan, I think, it needs to go back to basics, it needs to be strong, and it needs to be in an Act of Parliament. And I think that Act of Parliament needs to be a little bit like the Climate Change Act that we campaigned for successfully back in 2005-08, setting five-year targets, which is what that Climate Change Act led to. And we've got enough data in terms of songbird populations, soil health, the extent of different habitats to have five-year rolling targets for 25 and beyond. Because, as we all know, every environmental challenge in this country is not going to be solved by one parliament or one government. It's going to be handed on from one to the next. That's what the Climate Change Act did, and I think that's why we need an Environment Act in which that 25-year plan will be one part.
Thank you. David Jameson from City of Edinburgh Council. We hear lots nowadays about nature deficit disorder and the disengagement of people from nature. How do we begin to reverse this in our growing cities? I'm obviously thinking from Edinburgh in particular, but something relevant for all of us to go back with to begin to change.
I think the most basic thing is that it needs to be easy to be able to go into nature and to be able to interact with wild or semi-wild spaces. And that's really about proximity. And some of those statistics are, very top line ones earlier on. You know, the closer you live to those things, the more you use them and the bigger the benefit. And so, can we get better access for people who are far from those places? You know, more difficult in some areas than others. But can we create more of these spaces so that they're closer to the people? And I think that is the core of it. You know, can I get there? And, do I want to go there? So attractive places that look safe, they feel safe, and I can get access to it. And then it's really a cultural thing. So some people don't like to go out very much. They prefer to sit indoors. It's not very good for them. How do you get them out? Well, then, you can interact with people in different ways. I think the NGOs have got a big role. I know the Wildlife Trust put an enormous amount of time and effort in trying to get people into their reserves, and some of them are in urban areas.
And so partnerships actually between councils and some of the people who've got some of these places would be a good place to start, but quite low budget, I would have thought, in terms of how you can do that. Schools would be another very good way. One of the first jobs I ever did as a conservationist was a little project in Oxfordshire working with primary schools, taking the kids out during school time to go into the woods and like bring back twigs and draw pictures of them and stuff like that. And it had a transformative effect on these kids. And also the parents, I learned, were being taken out by the kids at weekends into these places just because they knew where it was and they knew it was a good place to go and you could show their mothers some bluebells. And that was quite powerful. I wonder now, that was over 30 years ago, I wonder now if actually you might have more difficulties with that in terms of rules about, you know, safety and children, goodness knows what. But it might be worth looking at in terms of partnerships with schools to get the kids out as a kind of, you know, as a kind of doorway into getting the adults there too. The Wildlife Trust can help with that, I would have thought.
We've got time for one quick question, Len.
Hi, Len Wyatt, individual from Bristol. Just to help you on that last one, I'm volunteering in the Northern Slopes in Bristol. One of the things that's taken off recently is concepts such as forest schools.
Yes.
And a lot of our local schools, about five or six junior schools within shouting distance, are actually asking people to arrange stuff to actually go out and experience even an urban area like the Northern Slopes in Bristol.
Great. Yeah. Indeed, so there's enormous potential for more of that, I would say.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much.
Thanks. Great. Thank you.